Okay, moving on to the last section, brachial plexus. Brachial plexus is basically a bundle of nerves that essentially start at the lower aspect of the cervical spinal cord. And they're a bunch of bundled nerves that come out and they come down into your axilla or your shoulder region, and they extend down into your arm. So it really feeds the motor function, motor and sensory function of the arms and shoulders. So let's kind of take a look here. Again, brachial plexus is a network of nerves originating from the levels of C5 to T1. Okay, so it's a bunch of nerves that come out and then they extend into your axilla and then into your arms. Okay, very similar to the lumbar plexus, which is found, you know, around L3, 4, and 5, and they bundle together and go down your leg, you know, which encompasses also the sciatic nerve, which we all heard about. So brachial plexus is almost like that bundle, but all the way up top. So the track of the brachial plexus runs parallel with the right subclavian artery and vein. So that's sort of the landmark that we use. Again, nerves are very, very small, almost like the size of angel hair pasta, is what I like to say. You know, especially at the peripheries, they get even smaller. So, you know, when we're scanning an MRI of the brachial plexus, we're really looking for a landmark to align it. So luckily for us techs, that nerve travels parallel with the right subclavian artery and vein, which is a pretty significantly large anatomical structure. So we kind of essentially align it with that. And then essentially, if you kind of scroll through your axials, you'll be able to see it moving and you'll know exactly where to plot those scans. Okay, so that landmark allows us to sort of essentially plot our scans. So we can see here on the image to the left, we have our right subclavian artery. And again, this is right side, but it also goes to the left side. And on the left side, it follows the left subclavian artery and vein. So very similar, right side, left side, nothing different. So artery coming out, okay, and it's just gonna run posterior to the artery, okay? So we can see that it runs posterior to the artery, but it passes through the first rib at the inferior aspect of this region, which I'm gonna describe in a second, is that first rib, and then the superior margin of that is the clavicle. So it passes right through that little junction there. Okay, that little junction is actually referred to the thoracic outlet. Okay, so you might have heard of a pathology called thoracic outlet syndrome. And in that case, there's sort of impingement. You know, it might be due to like this muscle being a little bit tight on that nerve, and it causes sort of this, you know, sensory dysfunction. Maybe it's tingling in the fingers. It could be many, many different things, but it's a thoracic outlet syndrome. Is compression on that nerve. Very similar to, carpal tunnel syndrome. You know, when you compress the nerve, the signal is not going to pass through as easily and as efficiently. So patient numbness, when the arm is above their head, so let's just say they're putting on a jacket, right? So if they do that, that's going to compress that thoracic outlet and will cause that sort of neural dysfunction. So, but again, so the main theory here that we want to convey is the brachial plexus comes out of the neck at the level of C5 to T1, and it passes through that thoracic outlet, okay? And it extends a little bit more laterally, which we can see here on this very easy to understand, coronal brachial plexus view here. So one thing we want to make sure of, and what we want you to know, there are three separate trunks. Okay, there's a superior, a middle, and an inferior. Okay, that superior is made up of the C5 and 6 neural roots coming out. Okay, and they bundle together to kind of pass more posterior on the arm. Middle would be central, and then inferior would be more anterior on the arm. But that middle margin, it consists of C7 and C8. And then, you know, the inferior is that sort of C8 and T1, neural pathways coming out. So as you pass through, you're going to see that, you know, as they come down, they are going to extend into the arm and they're going to branch off at separate regions. So we can see here that the middle trunk is going to turn into the cords. So again, that thoracic outlet will compress when you have your arm above your head. So let's take a look over here at the brachial plexus. So we can see here on this beautiful textbook view here that, you know, the nerves coming out of the neck will be bundled together. You can see these little bundles, and they're separated into three separate trunks. We have a superior trunk, a middle trunk, and an inferior trunk. Okay, as these separate and come off of the neck and then get bundled together, they're going to then feed the distal part of the arm, okay? So as you can see here, and if we follow, the superior trunk is going to extend down, okay, and will follow all the way down, and it will run into the median nerve, okay? So you can see here that that C5, 6, as we run it down, okay, it's going to bifurcate. It's going to bifurcate into both the musculocutaneous nerve that goes more laterally, and then it's going to come into the median nerve as well. The median nerve goes all the way down into your hand, and that's essentially the nerve that's compressed during the carpal tunnel syndrome. So the median nerve goes all the way to the fingers. Okay, so if there's a, you know, a disc herniation at C5 and 6, the pathway signal is going to be disrupted all the way down to the hand. Okay, so if you have someone who has numbness in their hand, you're automatically, or not automatically, but by theory, you're going to think or assume that there's some sort of pathology or disruption at C5-6. So if we look down at the middle trunk, okay, which is C7, okay, you can see and follow it, C7 and 8, it's going to follow, it's going to bundle together, okay, it's going to follow all the way down, okay, and you're going to see it turn into the radial nerve, okay, so that's going to come out all and run along the radius bone of the forearm. Okay, and go essentially to the thumb region, so the thumb side of the hand. Okay, the other nerve, okay, which is that inferior, is going to come off of the neck at C8 and T1, okay, bundled together, and it's going to run down and turn into the ulnar nerve, which runs on the inner side. Okay, so if you have your arm outstretched and you have your palm up, it's going to run along the inside of the elbow, so that's the ulnar region, and run all the way down towards the pinky side of the hand. Okay, so again, this is sort of the difference between the levels that come out of the neck and how they're bundled together at something called the brachial plexus. Okay, so let's take another look here a little bit more distally. So as we can see here, it's passing through the thoracic outlet, passing through, and as they bifurcate, they're going to essentially run into radial nerve, musculocutaneous nerve, median nerve, and ulnar nerve. Okay. So, and like I mentioned before, the axilla. So it's going to feed a little bit of, you know, neurological function in the shoulder, such as moving your trap. Okay. Sort of like that. That's the axillary nerve. So again, what I want you to all understand is that the brachial plexus comes off and it turns into axillary nerve, radial nerve, musculocutaneous nerve, median nerve, and ulnar nerve. Okay. So definitely memorize that for the test. Also, something to memorize is the thoracic outlet. The thoracic outlet is made up is the junction or the space between the clavicle and the first rib. All right, so let's take a look at what the brachial plexus looks like on MR. So this is going to be an oblique view because that brachial plexus is running sort of on a diagonal. So you're not going to go straight coronal. It's going to be, oh, it's going to go coronal, but then you're going to oblique it. Okay. And it's about a 30 degree oblique, but you can see here that, and again, look at A is the left subclavian vein. Okay. That's what we're using as our landmark. Okay. And if we find that, we're going to easily be able to find the brachial plexus. Okay, this image is a little bit grainy, and the reason why it's grainy is because it's a thin slice. It's about 2 millimeter slices with no gapping in between the slices. So it's going to come out a little bit grainy, but this is essentially, you know, a something that has to happen so we can catch the brachial plexus, because again, it is a small bundle of nerves. But we can see here, okay, we have the lateral plexus root. Okay, and then the medial plexus root kind of coming through. So we can see it kind of running right along here. Sometimes, just from my experience, you know, you might have someone who has a pretty bad shoulder injury and they have a whole bunch of fluid that's piling up here, compressing the nerve, which causes that thoracic outlet syndrome as well. So it doesn't necessarily have to be compression, you know, at the clavicle first rib junction or opening. It could also be for any other pathology reason. It could be a mass, you know, for I've seen that before. So there's all different types of pathologies that can happen at the brachial plexus. All right, so that's what it looks like on an oblique coronal view. Now, if we kind of go on a sagittal view, and again, you're not going to run your sagittal straight. You're going to run sagittal oblique, okay? Because remember, that nerve is traveling this way, so we want to make sure that we get it at a 90-degree angle. Once we do, we're able to actually see. This is a perfect view. I'm not going to toot my own horn, but I did take this picture. You know, we have the first rib, which is A. I'm sorry, the clavicle, which is A. Okay, D is going to be that first rib, which means that this junction or this opening here, labeled as E, is that thoracic outlet, okay? So B is going to be the brachial plexus, and then C, which is larger, is that subclavian vein. Also, a little incidental finding, if anyone can figure what this out is, I mean, it is labeled, but it's a silicone breast implant. So this is what we're doing. We're cutting. So when we say we're doing things in an axial view, right, when we're talking about it, that doesn't always mean that you're cutting from head to toe. Say we're doing the brachial plexus, which runs from left to right. Cross-section, or the axial view, technically, of the brachial plexus would be the sagittal view, because we're able to cut it in cross-section, right? So these nerves are essentially coming at us, right? Because we're scanning from left to right. All right, so that's what the oblique sagittal looks like. So again, hammering it home here, the thoracic outlet is the clavicle and the first rib opening, okay, which allows the subclavian vein and the brachial plexus to pass through. Okay, any questions, feel free. I'm going to try and drop some other videos here regarding the brachial plexus, and make sure that you study all the points that I mentioned to study. All right, thanks.